So what is a ghost? We have to kind of define this before we can talk about how we can look for ghosts. And I think if you, you know, encounter most ghosts, they're probably not going to look like that. This poor guy, I don't know how his head swelled to that size before he died, but it's a sad case. I think if you ask a lot of people what they think a ghost is, what do most people think a ghost is? What do you guys think it is? Most people think it's a disembodied soul, right? I don't know if I necessarily believe that. I don't know if I believe in the idea of a soul. And we can get into a big theological debate about all this. But at the bottom line, you know, it doesn't matter what you believe and where you think we go after we die. What I'm saying when I say I don't know if I believe in a soul means I don't know if there is a physical essence of us that we can't see that physically travels somewhere else when we die. I think that there's energy, we'll get into that. Another idea of what a ghost could be is that it could be a psychological imprint. Now this is something I think you probably all experience now and then. If you ever walk into a room after two people have been arguing, you can feel that tension in the air, even though nobody's saying anything. That's a psychological imprint. And most of the time, that will dissipate after a little while. But for some reason, and sometimes, there are certain factors that allow a psychological imprint to remain. And we'll get into some of those factors in a little bit. But just think about that being the energy that we expend, being tracked and being recorded. That could explain a lot of what we call residual haunts, which we'll get into. Another is the idea that a ghost could be a thought form, or what the Tibetans call the tulpa. These are ghosts that we create with our own mind. These are ghosts that are created because we go to a place like the Lizzie Borden House, and we say, wow, this place must be haunted. And if enough people go there and say that and think that, then the place will become haunted. If enough people concentrate, they can create a ghost. In the 1970s, there was an experiment done by the Toronto Society for Psychical Research that they called the Fellow Experiment. And what happened was they got a cross-section of society. They got a housewife, a lawyer, a doctor, a teacher, all these people. They put them all into a room together, and they said, we're going to create the backstory of the ghost. And they created this character named Philip, who was like a 15th century nobleman in England. And he fell in love with a woman he couldn't have and killed himself, and tragic story, all this, but none of it was actually true. They all had just made it up, like they were creating a character for a book or a play. And then after they created this whole backstory, they sat down and they had seances, because that's pretty much the best technology they had at the time for detecting ghosts. So they sat down and they held a couple of seances, and during those seances, they contacted the spirit of this character, Philip. And they would ask questions based on the background that they had created, and they would get the answers from Ouija boards, through mediums, whatever else they were using, they would get these answers. And so they realized that it is possible to create a spirit, something that never existed, but still create that intelligence that you can interact with. And a lot of people don't like this theory, because they want to think that ghosts are our dead loved ones still around us. And sure, some of them probably are. But I think this is a very cool definition of a ghost. This means that sometimes when we go to haunted places, or the places that we think are haunted, and the door slams shut on its own, that means we did that with our own minds. That means we can do all these knocks and sounds and all these different things that people are feeling and experiencing. And I think that's really cool. That's that Jedi mind trick stuff. And I'd much rather think that I could sit on my couch and I could make that remote that's on the other side of the couch come all the way into my hand and think that my dead grandma is watching me while I take a shower. And then another possibility is that a ghost is a time slip or a quantum event. We've all experienced a time slip before. I think we've all had deja vu. Well, that's kind of like the idea of a time slip, where for just a brief moment, we don't know where we are in time. And when we have those moments, that's when ghosts from the past can come through. Now, a quantum event's a little bit different. Is anybody out there a quantum physicist? No? Good. Okay. I always worry because when I start talking about parallel universes and the multiverse and all that, I'm waiting for like Neil deGrasse Tyson to be sitting in the back row and being like, well, Tim, actually that's not exactly right. But the idea behind the multiverse, behind quantum physics, is that there are multiple universes that are all happening at the same time. And they're all brushing up against each other. And sometimes when we experience a ghost or have a paranormal experience, we're actually getting a glimpse into that other dimension, into that other universe. And then the questions always come up, well, How come the ghost that I see then is dressed in colonial era clothes if it's somebody from another universe? And my answer to that is maybe in that universe it's still colonial times. Or maybe in that universe it's still 2019, but people dress that way. You know, there's all these different possibilities when you get into that idea of multiverse. I like to say that every eventuality is a reality. So every choice that we make, it's like a choose your own adventure book for anybody that ever read one of those. You know, it'll tell you, like, if you want to jump the ravine, go to page 49. If you want to try to climb down the ravine, go to page 75. Well, just because you went to page 75 and followed the story in that way, that doesn't mean that page 49 doesn't exist. So every eventuality is a reality. You know, when you woke up this morning, you might have had a choice between having eggs for breakfast or having cereal. So you had eggs, and now here we are. But in another universe, you woke up and you had cereal. And maybe in that universe, you'd still be right here, but maybe your day would have gone completely different. So when these universes rub up against each other, and we see into it, that could explain ghosts. It could also mean that to other universes, we look like ghosts to them. So keep that in mind when you're walking around the house in underwear. The bottom line is that ghosts are energy. The second law of thermodynamics tells us energy cannot be created or destroyed, it can only be changed. So the energy that makes us up when we die, the energy that powers our bodies, when we pass away, the energy doesn't pass away with us. It goes off and it forms bonds with other energies. But for some reason, sometimes it retains the energy that makes us up. And maybe it can even retain the intelligence of who we were. And we'll get into not only some of the reasons why that might happen, but also how we can detect that and quantify it.